Definitely there are parties in developing countries that may be controlled by the military. In Latin America, it was common during military dictatorships, they could create a party. They would even create an opposition party. But it was just, you know, all sort of smoke. And it was about, you know, having something there that they could kind of control. Some other examples.
Somalia, for example, not the party, but the government. Like, it's basically not a government, but it's controlled by all the warlords in Somalia.
Okay, so parties there are almost not really existing. But any party that does exist would probably be controlled by a leader. Wael, and then Raluca? No.
Yes.
Oh, God. Okay, good. Nowhere that I got that one. Okay, well.
The Muslim Brotherhood.
Okay, so who's controlling the party?
Basically, so the ones, let's say, outside Egypt are being controlled by the ones in Egypt.
Okay. Okay, excellent. Okay, Raluca?
I was thinking about the change of regime in Afghanistan, where the U.S. kind of influenced the way the elections were organized or the parties that could compete in there and stuff.
Yeah, well, the parties there are really, really weak. And whatever is existing is either... The U.S. has tried to control it, but not done that good a job of it, whatever its interests are. Karzai's party is not really a party. It would be controlled by him. A lot of parties in sub-Saharan Africa where the dictator kind of creates a token party, and you see that it's not autonomous. There's some questions in the literature about Hezbollah. Is it controlled by Iran? And the Secretary General would say, no, we're not, that we are autonomous. But you get the idea here. Judicial branches that are not autonomous may receive phone calls directly from leaders about how to decide cases, how to decide court cases, which is sometimes referred to as telephone law. That the judges receive a call, this is how you're supposed to decide the case, and that's how the cases are decided. A legislature that's called a pocket legislature is not autonomous, they're in the pocket of the executive. Coherence of organizations and procedures, so does it make sense? Are there rules? Are there institutions? Is it adhered to consistently? Do you have a party that is arguing for this and then really is arguing for something completely different? Are they changing their mind so often that it just doesn't really make sense to anybody? So there has to be a set of rules and procedures and kind of predictability to things. So all these factors are the ways that Huntington measures institutionalization, but you can come up with other factors that you think are important. But if you use this, then you know, be sure again to put parentheses in the year and the citation. So he also coined the term political decay, which we'll be talking about a lot, where you have, there's lots of different types of decay where there can be political institutions, administrative institutions, security institutions, or judicial, but it's where you have some kind of institution and it starts to corrode and fall apart. It's not working as well as it was. The rules that were guiding it are now being guided by personal decisions. Merit is going out the window and you see more cronyism. And so political decay is some sort of institutional decline, political disintegration. With a party, it would be like, I'll give you an example of a party that is decayed, and then you can come up with some more examples. One of the best examples would be Zimbabwe's ZANU-PF that emerged after independence, and it had an ideology, it was more sort of left-leaning. A lot of the ideology and the platform was sort of based on empowerment of the Africans. But it had a nationwide reach, so it wasn't just sort of like a local party or an ethnic party. And a lot of grassroots involvement, there was like social rootedness and connection with the party and individuals in the country. And as time has gone on, Mugabe has personalized this party, and it's not really much of anything. It's, I mean, there's mercenaries hired to work on his behalf. He has, whatever ideology, just is gone. And it's really machine that he uses to help him get reelected again and again. Can you think of parties that have decayed? Yes.
The CPP in Ghana under Kwame Nkrumah. That just basically, towards the end, he was just announcing on the radio he was an MP anymore. And there was no, his party didn't stand for anything apart from his own rule. Really.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good example, because that party emerged with like a socialist agenda as well, and then it started to sort of disintegrate, and it really didn't come have any meaning anymore.
The IPP in Ireland.
Okay.
Of the century, the 20th century.
Okay, so what did you tell me about? Because I'm not familiar.
They were basically the main party in power, and then Sinn Féin came to power, and then 1916 happened in the Anglo-Irish War, and they just kind of waned. No one kind of supported them. They just kind of bust.
Okay, so they fell apart as competition came and they weren't able to adjust.
Yeah.
And so they weren't adaptable enough. Okay, good. Anybody else? Luisa.
The Liberal Party in Honduras.
Okay.
They were pretty much the most popular party, like president got picked more often. And the coup happened, and then it just split apart into, because they were more left-leaning, so now they're nowhere, and then they split into the Libre, which is means freedom, obviously. So they're nowhere in, and they're not going to get elected again, and they have no ideals behind them. They just have the same old people, and it doesn't have an ideology anymore.
Right. Okay, same kind of thing happened with Venezuela's two main parties, that they moved so close to the center, you couldn't, the AEC and COPE, you couldn't really tell them apart, or AD, I think, in COPE, and there wasn't really much of an ideology distinguishing them. Ba'ath parties as well. The Ba'ath Party emerged in the Middle East more sort of socialist leaning. It did have an agenda of things that it was trying to accomplish, and then it fell apart. So we see that, according to Huntington, political decay, like a symptom or a result of political decay, is you can have a lot of instability because you don't have institutions to kind of manage things, to manage people's demands and so forth. Corruption would be the obvious one because their rules are falling apart. So when rules are adhered to, then there isn't really corruption. I mean, there could be a lot of rules that you don't like, but if it's really clear ahead of time what the rules are, and they're applied evenly to everybody, then it's not corruption. Corruption is when you start to circumvent rules and give favors to friends and family members. Or you start to just go around the rules to hoard money yourself. Authoritarianism I put in bold because, so Huntington says this, but I don't think this is necessarily true, because you can have dictatorships that are really well institutionalized. Not that many of them, but they exist. Like Singapore, in China to some extent. But Singapore, definitely. It doesn't have instability, it's not corrupt. The party itself has an ideology. It is more or less autonomous from the leadership. So that, you really need to put an asterisk by that. The tendency, though, is that authoritarianism and institutional decay go hand in hand. But there are, of course, always exceptions to this rule where that's not necessarily the case, and violence. So we'll keep going with this, more signs of this. So what leads to it, from Huntington, he says, well, this is his version of it. And this comes from a group of scholars that were modernization theorists, that modernization is good, but he was sort of twisting it and saying, actually, modernization can lead to problems. If you modernize really, really fast, there's going to be rising demands and expectations, and then that's going to be really hard to meet if you don't have strong institutions to deal with it. So when you see mobilization that's not matched by institutionalization, you're going to see decay and chaos and all kinds of problems. That was his early thesis. He said, sort of counterintuitively, that rapid economic growth would breed political instability because there would be sort of more demands on the state as growth took place. And there'd be these, what's known as the revolution of rising frustration, that they want to take part more in what's going on in the government, and if you don't have the institutions that can help make that happen, there's going to be a lot of frustration. Okay, we'll talk about this in a second. But we need to pause here because not every scholar agrees with this, that rapid economic growth breeds political instability. In fact, there's a group of scholars that completely disagree, like Adam Shawersky, which you will read if you, I'll write his name down because you're never going to be able to spell it. Et al. And he does a lot of work on authoritarianism and the effects of that. Okay, so he says that actually economic growth makes regimes more stable. So if they're authoritarian, they're going to stay more stable, and if they are democratic, they're going to stay more stable. So it's like a U curve that takes place. And he uses a, you know, a very large N study to kind of test this. And so he would argue the authoritarian regimes, they actually become more stable with economic growth because this sort of feeds their legitimacy and makes it easier for them to repress and so forth. Okay, why don't we then get into a distinction between populism and personalism, because these are two causes of decay that I would see are probably more important than modernization. Modernization, we do have some examples that we'll get to in a second, but why don't we talk about populism and personalism? First of all, what is the difference between populism and personalism? Because populist leaders have personalist tendencies, but not all personalist leaders are populist. That'll make sense as we explain it. Anyone? Well.
Personalist leader can have the rule, you know, basically based on him, about his character, about who he is as
yeah.
a person that he sent from God.
Right, the state personifies him,
yeah.
right?
Populist leader, as you said, can be personalist, but it's more about an ideology, a certain thing that they're following for the collective. That's what the populist leaders usually demonstrate.
The populist leader will be more likely to try to espouse an ideology, that's true, that's based on pleasing a wide range of people. We'll keep going with this. Good start. Okay, who else wants to add? Okay, so just to get you guys going, so the personalist leader, as Wael said, they tend to want to embody the state. They don't want any other institutions to really function very much. They want all power in their own hands. They're really concerned with staying in power. In order to do so, they'll do the following things. They'll weaken the legislature, they'll weaken the, or they'll make elections more fraudulent if they have elections. They will weaken the bureaucracy, they'll weaken the military by coup-proofing it. And all power is really in their own hands. Now, in contrast to the populist leader, they are not afraid to use repression. They don't really always care what the public thinks. And they don't really care if they're always popular. That's going to be different than populism. A populist leader also wants to deinstitutionalize the regime and create direct links between themselves and the population. But they want to have a lot of legitimacy, and they try to please everybody with distributional policies where they're giving out a lot of handouts. So populist leaders tend to be somewhat personalistic because they also tend to promote cults of personality. Their photo is everywhere, and they tend to use a lot of rhetoric that's about them sometimes. But they genuinely may want their legitimacy to rest on popularity rather than on fear. So why don't we give some examples to contrast? Yes, Stuart.
They say Hugo Chavez was popular. So
yes.
He loved using referendums to get around any constitutional problems he had.
Mm-hmm.
Then he could say the people wanted. He wouldn't have to go for a senate or anything like that. But a person's leader, you could say, from Brutu was like that. He didn't care what anyone thought. He just stole the money he wanted, and that was that.
Yes. Okay. So you have one leader who's giving a lot of distribution out, getting around things through local, you know, referendums and so forth. Deinstitutionalizing the regime quite a bit, but a lot, you know, enjoyed some genuine popularity. Whereas the personalist leader, you would never know. They may have elections where they win with 95% of the vote, then they have a big parade for them, and everything's really great and exciting. Did you, Edwin?
Yeah, I was going to ask, where do you think Gaddafi would be?
Personalist. He had some oil wealth that he distributed a little bit of, but it was really all about him. And he said he didn't even have a position for his own leadership. He was too important. He didn't even call himself president. He was that important to Libya. Yeah.
Did you say Lenin was populist and then Stalin was personalist?
Yeah, okay. I don't know. That's really interesting. I think that Stalin, there was a party there that had some meaning.
But in terms of him compared to Lenin, he did take it to the extremes.
He became more personalistic.
Yeah,
yeah, he deinstitutionalized the party during that period. And Mao, the same for China. And the results were not that good. Matt, you had it?
Yeah, just what's the leaders about, like Belarus? Alexander,
yes, Lukashenko? Yes, personalist.
Yeah.
Personalist, yes. That's a really good example. That's one of the more modern personalist dictators that has really made it all about him. You can detect a personalist leader if they create an ideology and it's named after them. Like they just take their last name and then add ism, Mobutu-ism. Such thing exists. And like Gaddafi that we mentioned, he had a green book that everybody had to read. That was, I don't know, comprised his musing, whatever he was pontificating about at that moment. And everybody was meant to read it as if it was sort of coming straight from, you know, whatever. So hopefully we can distinguish between these two. So the populist leader is more benign. The populist leader is not really very good for institutions, and the legacy is often not that great. However, they aren't as detrimental to the population as the personalist leader that really could care less about their own people, and there isn't really, and usually they're hoarding and stealing. Another reason for weakness of institutions, and because the class deals so much with failed states and weak states and so forth, is that at independence, a lot of countries weren't really given much to work off of. The region that was the worst off after independence was where?
Christina?
Yes, because colonization came late. When it did come, it was very catastrophic. The independence came very late, in some cases not until the 1970s. And whatever pre-colonial institutions they had, the European colonizers destroyed and changed them to suit their own needs. The only institution that they built up at all, if any, was the military. In the case of Botswana, for some reason, the British decided to leave the pre-colonial institutions alone. So we look at Botswana, and some of its success, both economically and politically, they were able to use all these institutions, set up a parliament, and the parliament is well institutionalized, as is the main party there. Okay, so getting to another thing, is that a lot of the African states, they emerged and they had parliamentary systems. And parliamentary systems tend to be better for a lot of different things, for democracy and so forth, even though they've gotten a bad rap. Botswana is one of the few parliamentary systems left in Africa, though, because a lot of these countries in sub-Saharan Africa, they just changed their parliamentary systems to a presidential system. Why? What would be the reason? Say, well, okay, we got a parliamentary system, don't like it, I'm going presidential. Yes.
It's easier to hold the power if you're a president as opposed to in that kind of...
Yeah, exactly. It's easier to hold power. Okay, so we have presidential systems all over Latin America, presidential systems all over sub-Saharan Africa, and then you have some exceptions, and those exceptions are the parliamentary systems, and they work much better. Conflict as well. Why is conflict so bad for institutions? And by conflict, I mean armed conflict, tensions, high tensions. Christina.
Well, because if you have a conflict, all the government is going to concentrate on either trying to, like, if you have rebels, for example, if you have an insurgency, you're trying to squash that. You don't concern yourself with any of the infrastructure, any of the services needed by the people, nothing. You just invest in the military, and you get, like, alarming rates of, like, investment in the military, and that's...
Right. Infrastructure gets destroyed, administrative servants, civil servants aren't paid.
Also, if there's conflicts, how can the actual people who aren't involved in the conflict, like, trust the government that's in power if they can't actually sort that conflict out?
Yeah, so there's very low levels of trust, which makes
it
difficult to compromise within legislatures and so forth. Anybody else? Did I see someone's hand up? Okay, so conflict is really bad in many different ways. A new study showed that the mode of transition from authoritarian breakdown, if it's really conflictual, the chances for democracy are really low. So it would be saying that the Syrian case, the mode of transition has been very violent, and it would mean that the chances for democracy afterwards are going to be really tough. You have two sides that have identities that have been heightened through the conflict. You've had a lot of bad blood between one another. The institutions have been sort of broken down. There's not services there. Trust is really low, and that makes it difficult for a smooth transition to take place. Heightened ethnic identities, that gets into that kind of factor. When parties are based on ethnic lines, when parliaments or legislatures are divided by ethnic lines, when judiciaries can be making decisions based on ethnicity, or they're only recruiting judges from one particular ethnic group, or administrative organizations are only filled with a particular ethnic group, or military is only filled with a particular ethnic group, and ethnic identities are heightened, they don't function that well. Okay, so we have a lot of,
When you say ethnic identities, can that also be religious identities?
Yeah, I should clarify that. So it could be religious, ethnic, all those kinds of things. Militarism can be bad, where military spending gets very high and the military starts trying to play a role in the government. And in the 1960s, they used to say that the military is the best institution to kind of run the country, because it was the most institutionalized institution at the time based on Latin America. But we find that military governments, they don't know what they're doing, and any economic growth that takes place in military governments is in spite of them, not because of them. I think there's one more reason, if not, a security limit, okay. It's more or less the same thing. High military spending, high levels of militarism. When you get the military involved in making decisions in the legislature, the military is involved in political parties too much, or they're involved in the administrative apparatus. We'll look at Pakistan. These civil servants, a lot of them are from the military. The legislature is filled with a lot of people from the military. I mean, the decisions are made based on, what's going to benefit the military. All right, so these are a lot of different reasons that can lead to the disintegration of political institutions and just institutions in general. Now, why don't we come back to this and look at Huntington's rationale. We have mobilization that's not matched by institutionalization. So people are mobilized. They're on the streets. They are upset. But there aren't political parties to capture their and aggregate their interests. Then you're going to have a lot of chaos. We see this in Egypt. Speaking with my GTA, Shima, who's from Egypt, and you may know her from the Middle East class, she's talking about this all the time, this very chaotic ad hoc response to things that's not being able to organize itself well because there isn't institutionalization to match mobilization. So now Egypt has high levels of mobilization, but not institutionalization. All right, any questions about what I mean by political decay? Because it's one of the things you're tested on. Excellent. So signs are coups. If you see that there are a lot of coups and military interventions, and there's high levels of militarism, it means they can't decide things based on elections because they can't figure out how to compromise. It probably means the legislature isn't functioning that well, so the military feels that it's got to step in. It's a sign of high levels of instability. So where is the region in the world where there have been the most coups?
West Africa.
You got very specific. That's good. Okay, so Africa, we'll say Sub-Saharan Africa, and you're right, West Africa. Karen?
I was going to say Nigeria.
There's been a lot of coups there as well. Okay, you guys are getting specific with countries. Wild?
South America.
Yeah, okay, so in Latin America there have been a lot of coups, not as many as in Africa, but definitely that's the region that has had the second most coups, and one in Honduras not that long ago. And then you see also party organizations going down and the rise of these charismatic leaders, and they come to power to sort of serve as the savior. Okay, we see this happening actually in Zambia at the moment. Very interesting. Zambia had a dictatorship for many, many years under Kenneth Kaunda. He had a party that he used to sort of help him run things called the UNDP, but it fell apart more or less as he was ousted from power in the early 90s. Then they tried to have this multi-party system. And again, another very charismatic leader, Frederick Chiluba, emerged, and it was very difficult. And then they had a brief period where the leadership was technocratic, but this technocratic leader died suddenly of a stroke. And their most recent election in 2011 was the election of a leader named Michael Sata. And just some of the things just to touch upon, because I'm talking about the decline of party organizations. He has a party that emerged from the original opposition party to the UNDP, but he, in every interview on a radio show that he has been conducted, he would sort of change his mind about the platform of the party. It just keeps kind of moving and changing. And his most exceptional quality is his ability to criticize the opposition, make fun of them, and to just be a very charismatic type of person. So we see the rise of these types of leadership. The party doesn't really matter to him. It's the patriotic front, is what it's called. But we see this elsewhere as well. Where else? We see the rise of charismatic leaders and the decay of other organizations.
Is that like in Russia, for example?
Are you talking about with Putin?
Yeah,
well, we're seeing he's personalizing power more in his hands, in his authoritarian. He left briefly, and then he came back. So he never really left.
Because the party declined, didn't it?
Yeah, the party is just, it's whatever. Yeah. Nothing there. It has a little bit of a, it's probably somewhere in the center, yeah.
Can you say custom?
That's a really good one. It has an ideology, though. You're right that he... Okay, so he's a complicated character, right? Because he's very charismatic and he really loves attention. And he personified Cuba so much. Like, when we think of Cuba, we think of Castro. And that's not the same thing with Raul, his brother, who is much less charismatic type of person and much more committed to the ideology. But you may see that sometimes with a party that is very well institutionalized, but you've got this leader that really wants to hold on and really attract quite a bit of attention.
But yep. Do you think he's committed to the ideology because he's opening up slowly?
Well, he has to. So you can still be really committed and have really no choice. And they had to do that as well after the Cold War ended and they lost Soviet support. But I think he has there's a level of ideological commitment there. It's not like some leaders that whatever they're saying means has absolutely no meaning. Guillermo.
Turkey.
Okay, talk to me about that. What do you mean?
Well, you mean the leader.
Are you talking about the AKP with Erdogan?
No, we were talking just now.
go ahead.
Yeah, the leader that stays in power and institutionalized.
Because if you're talking about the current case, I think you're actually right with Erdogan and the AKP. That the party was looking very good and very well institutionalized, and it was winning a lot of elections and with popular. It occupied sort of a center-right position. It was pro-EU, a Muslim, modern Muslim moderate party. But Erdogan is a very charismatic type. He's really starting to tighten things. The repression that's taken place in light of the protests and so forth. And we're seeing how long is he going to take power. I don't know if I told you this, but I was at this meeting where there's all these Turkish peoples, and it was one of the former foreign ministers of Turkey. And a lot of the people at the meeting, it was like a public forum, were really, really upset with the AKP government, really, really, really upset with what had happened and all the protests and so forth. And this guy asked a really, really good question to the former foreign minister, who was one of the founding members of the AKP. He said, can you challenge Erdogan in your cabinet meetings? And he didn't answer the question. Can you? Yeah, that's a really good question. That's a really good question. Can you challenge the leader in a cabinet meeting? Can you say something and they have to kind of listen to it? And of course, we'll never know because I'm not involved in these cabinet meetings and seeing what's going on. But sometimes there's minutes on things and you can get quotations and so forth. But that's the type of thing that you would want to know.
But doesn't he still have an ideology, though?
What'd you say?
Doesn't he still have his own ideology? Does he not?
Erdogan?
Yeah. Because he hasn't gone that far from the original parties.
Yes, he does.
He's gone a bit further, but like not.
I agree. The party has an ideology. It's mostly stuck to it. It just seems that he's become very powerful. Mm. So there's some questions. And actually, the people at this meeting were very anti. I was surprised, because I didn't know that this kind of sentiment existed to this extent. Yeah.
I was going to ask if in North Korea, can we consider Kim Jong-il the charismatic leader? Because they kind of like him a lot.
Okay. So the North Korea case is very, very interesting because it does have a party and it is really sticking to its guns on its ideology. I mean, they are going down and they don't care. And they're just like, we are going to go really badly. South Korea is doing great, obviously, and we are doing terrible. We do not care. We will stick to this as everybody else is changing and adapting. So there is clearly some kind of ideology that's there, and there's a party. There are a lot of people that are committed or something to this party. There's a military that is committed. But there has been this tendency towards charismatic leadership of the Kim family, of Kim Il-sung, Kim Jong-il, and Kim Jong-un. And each leader is not only charismatic, but extremely quirky and odd and weird. But it's important to note because they have these odd things and they want, it's not constrained by anyone, right? Normally this kind of odd, weird behavior would be constrained and the press would, you know, get a hold of it. But they're just kind of doing their thing and anyway, so there are very crazy stuff going on in North Korea, but which we could talk about at another point in time. All right, so we'll talk about the importance of institutions. And these are quotes from Huntington. So really good comments and examples there. So he's saying, what does this mean? He says, the most important political distinction among countries concerns not their form of government, but their degree of government. What does that mean? What's he saying? Amen. And then Jennifer?
Okay. I mean, they could be a democratic government. They have the form of a democratic government, but how far they are actually democratic depends on what they're doing within that government.
Okay, so not sure I get what you're saying, however.
So, I mean, you might get some like countries that say that we're a democratic government, we're going to be putting this for a referendum, we're going to let you have elections, when really, you know, it's just a sort of facade. Whereas it actually depends on the institutions within that government, how far democratic they are.
Okay, I don't know if he's talking about that per se. We'll get back to see if that's what you were actually saying. We'll go to Jennifer first and then Christina.
So it doesn't matter what type of regime it is, but how well they're governed?
Yeah, so it doesn't matter if you're a democracy or not, but how well you're governed. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know if you might have been trying to say that. Christina, do you want to add?
I was thinking of, for example, competitive authoritarian regimes.
Right.
Like, they have the form of democracy. Like, they say, oh, we're democracy, we have elections. But in the actual core, they're corrupt and they're literally squander the money and they don't do anything for the people, but they do still have that form of all their democracies.
They have elections.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Elections,
they have elections,
a lot of authoritarian regimes have elections. That's actually really, really common. A lot of them have parties and a lot of them have legislatures. Very, very few don't have these things anymore because they're trying to get with the program or whatever. But and also because, as it turns out, having these things, they think it helps elongate their tenure in power. But an election only has meaning if there's really turnover in power at some point or some kind of uncertainty involved. And if the election doesn't have that much uncertainty, there is no uncertainty about who's going to win the elections in Russia. Right? Is there? I don't know. I mean, I would bet on Putin if I were you. Or if you were to look at Belarus as well, they have elections. That means we know who's going to win. So the whole point of elections, when they're well institutionalized, is that they have some kind of uncertainty to them. So in terms of what this is talking about with the degree of government, you know, you could have an authoritarian regime where you have no uncertainty about elections, like Singapore. The PAP party is going to win over and over again. But he's saying, well, that doesn't matter. Okay. What matters more is that it's a well-governed country. It may not be a place you want to live, but it's a well-governed country because the rules are clearly stated and they have very low levels of corruption and so forth.
Like China.
China also, to some extent, that you have to say is well-governed, though you don't have to agree with everything, right? There's a lot of problems. But there's a certain extent you have to say it has been well-governed. He also says violence and instability was the product of rapid social change and rapid mobilization of new groups into politics, so all these new groups trying to get into politics, but is not matched by the political institutions. So that's where we're talking about the Egyptian case. There was another guy, okay, I met this at a conference, a Tunisian expert, constitutional law expert, and he said one of the biggest disappointments for him is that they held elections before they created a constitution. And he just thought that this was a really big problem because they really needed to work on the constitution, kind of take their time, before they kind of rushed into elections, that they went too much too soon, and there's a lot of pressure from the international community that once you have authoritarian breakdown, you gotta hold elections, or you know, everybody is gonna get upset that you don't have elections, and sometimes they need a little bit more time for parties to form and to have sort of like an interim period.
The primary problem of politics, again, this is saying the same type of thing, is the lag, again, Huntington, lag in the development of political institutions behind social and economic change. So give time for parties to form, legislatures to form, and then they can incorporate social change. And you don't have to agree with it. It's very hard, right? Because you want things to happen quickly, and there's very much a sentiment of frustration from publics that have endured years and decades of you know, dictatorship. Okay, so now we turn to authoritarianism, and this is getting to what Christina was talking about.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, oh yeah, please.
Does he use, from what I gather, does he use like political development and political decay as two different sides of, I mean,
yeah,
if you don't have political development, you'll definitely have political decay and the other way around.
Well, you can
like
have stagnancy.
Like
you can stagnate,
yeah.
But the decay is when everything starts to get personalized. It becomes about a person, institutions disappear, rules aren't really managing things, it's really about, you know, personal relationships. Okay, so we turn to dictatorships, authoritarianism, and okay, there's two literatures, the democracy literature, which is really full, and there's about a million different people writing on democracy and measuring democracy. There are several global democracy indices out there, many of which people don't like. Nobody likes the Freedom House. it was 1972 that it started publishing. It's global. It has all kinds of methodological problems and biases. But it's there. Then you have the Economist Index, which was published since 2006. And it's probably less biased, but it also has a lot of methodological problems in terms of how they're collecting data and coder reliability issues and so forth. Then there is the Polity series, which is mainly used by academics, and they criticize it, but they use it. It's typical. And then you have a really minimalist data set, which is really used by people who study dictatorships, which is the Democracy and Dictatorship data set, or another data set by Barbara Rigetti's. But when you have like a really large data set in trying to measure democracy, so if you are looking at measuring democracy and so forth, what they tend to do in order to deal with the fact that they have to code this for all these different countries is they come up with a definition of democracy that's very simplistic. And so this very simplistic minimalist definition, which comes from Joseph Schumpeter. So when you see a minimalist definition of democracy, you would put Schumpeter in parentheses. It's just about elections. If you have elections that have some sort of meaning and there's turnover in power of the executive, then you are democratic. And that would mean that you create like binary categories. One is dictatorships. And then another category of democracies. So there's going to be a lot of democracies that maybe are very flawed, that fall into the democratic category, and a lot of dictatorships that some might not seem that bad, that fall into that category. Philip Schmitter and Terry Lynn Carl, they had a big article on what democracy is not, and so that's what dictatorships are. And so they talk about more things like citizen rights and competition, majority rule, cooperation, deliberation, and representation. But another scholar that's well known, Robert Dahl, who was born in 1915, I believe he's still alive. Yes. How old is that? That is quite a hundred. Almost 100.
Dahl.
Dahl. Discussing it. Two things about Dahl. His definition of democracy, and I read it all the time, is participation and contestation. So he adds to the Schumpeter definition, which only focuses on contestation, and he adds participation. So then you may want to add civil liberties and civil rights, like Carolyn Carl and Schmitter do. But your definition of democracy and authoritarianism, if you choose to write on something like this, you come up with it on your own, you put in parentheses who's inspiring you. Maybe you choose just to use the Dahlian version or Schumpeterian version. But when coming up with a definition of democracy, you just have to be clear where this is coming from and use that sort of to push forth with your papers. This is the Economist Index. So the reason why they like these global maps, so you kind of get a picture. Where democracy is, which is mostly in Northern Europe, Northwestern Europe, and you see Canada, US, Australia, to a lesser extent Japan, and then you have the region that we're looking at right here, which is mostly authoritarian. And we also look a little bit at Sub-Saharan Africa, which is authoritarian, and then you have Latin America, which is more leaning towards democracy. You don't have to agree with what they've done here. I'm just trying to give you an idea of mapping, global mapping of democracy, and the purpose is you kind of get an idea of a relative stance of different countries. So we turn to make a distinction between totalitarianism and authoritarianism, and then we're going to look at the types of authoritarianism. So totalitarianism was a word that was used very often, so I know I've taught this before, so we'll just kind of repeat for those of you that have heard me speak about it before, and it might be new for some of you. It was kind of thrown around very loosely that a country is totalitarian when there's really only one regime right now that is, which is? Right, because totalitarianism is a lot of work. It requires all kinds of work from the regime to keep people in a constant state of mobilization. They have to be activated and mobilized to adhere to the government's agenda. And they want to atomize society into one. They want to restructure society. Stuart.
Where does Eritrea fit into that?
Okay, that's really interesting. So I got an email from someone from Eritrea that said, you need to also think about Eritrea as totalitarian. And he had a very long list of the reasons why it is totalitarian. And I thought it was very convincing, but I don't know that case that well. So what made you think of it? That's very good. You just have to know about it?
It's terrible. I mean,
yeah.
The stuff I've read about it, people are put into, like, in the army, and you don't even know you can leave.
Yeah.
It's just your military service, and the government tells you when you can leave. So you're not paid either, really.
Yeah.
So, you know, you cannot leave. And, like, most of the immigrants who are dying in the Mediterranean, mostly from Eritrea or Somalia, mostly.
Yeah.
So there is something going on there.
Yeah, no, something is going on that's really, there's a cult of personality being established, a mobilization of the people into the military, very high levels of militarism, high levels of military spending, absolutely no freedom, just so repressive. It's interesting.
There was a coup d'etat earlier last year, well, a failed one.
A failed, yeah.
They took over the radio station, but then...
Yeah, you gotta do more than the radio.
Then the radio said everything's fine after that, so... No one knows what went on, but something's going on there.
Right. Yes?
From that aspect, would you consider Israel as one? Constant, you know, campaigning, moving society, military...
No. I know... Do you? No, I don't. It's not to me, but it could be to somebody else. I mean, because they have elections and free speech for those that are Israeli citizens. So, I mean, they can leave too. An Israeli can leave the country and do what they want to do, whereas someone in North Korea cannot leave. Also, they can take a job that they want to do. They can work what they want to work. And someone in North Korea couldn't work where they want to work. I mean, the North Koreans are really suffering with terrible malnourishment. So though the state of Israel, you disagree with it on a lot of different fronts, there are services that are being provided to some of its citizens that if they were polled, they wouldn't say it is, right? It's just more its foreign policy, right? Domestic policy, right? Okay. So totalitarianism came from Hannah Arendt. She wrote about it like in the 1940s, and she said the reason why it emerged because of capitalism and alienation. People felt really alienated by capitalism and globalization and modernization, and they needed something to kind of feel connected. And the totalitarian regime emerged to tie everybody together, to atomize, like I said, society as one, to create one group of people with one mind, and that was it. And Lynn said it emerged because of nationalism, so you saw some of these nationalist movements, and there might have been ethnic tensions due to immigration. You see sort of the fascist aspects. So we see these kind of regimes emerging in, like, the Soviet Union, you could argue Germany, that were really controlling and very oppressive with a huge security apparatus that, and secret police. It's the other aspect of it, is the secret police is everywhere watching what you're doing. There's no freedom at all. Okay, let me move that. What did I want to say? There's something else I wanted to add to that. All right. Sorry, I fast-forwarded through that slide because it wasn't important to what I was going to say. So totalitarianism got used a lot because there was someone from the Reagan administration, Gene Kirkpatrick, who started saying, well, some regimes are authoritarian and some regimes are totalitarian. And she said, communist regimes are totalitarian and non-communist regimes are authoritarian. And then she said, well, the totalitarian regimes are bad and they can't reform. The authoritarian regimes are good, and therefore we can give them money if we need to. And so then we start to use the word totalitarian very loosely. So I would prefer you don't use it that loosely. I see it often, sometimes in papers, that something is a totalitarian regime. But I mean, this is really talking about a level of repression that you can't even imagine, mind control and so forth. Maybe even Uruguay during the military dictatorship might have fallen in that category. I mean, because they exercised thought control where you could be imprisoned based on having an improper thought. These are the kinds of things that we're talking about here. So let's turn to authoritarianism, and why do authoritarian regimes, before we get to this, why do they not want to have a mobilized public? Why do they want the public to be apathetic and to not care? Chris?
It's easy to control them. I mean, yeah, it's just easy to control them, and there's less opposition.
Right. So they don't want to activate them, like the totalitarian, because they don't have the energy or resources. Did I see Wael's hand up, or is it Tyrant?
Lack of accountability as well, like they're not really that interested in like what's going on, and they're not going to form groups against you, then you don't have to like tell them what you've done, basically.
Right, so exactly. So in a lot of authoritarian regimes, people can kind of live their lives. As long as they don't bother the government too much, you're fine. Just don't disrupt or challenge us, just stay apathetic or whatever. And they want the image of the government to be good, but it's they're not going to bend over backwards to just try to please everybody and mobilize everybody. Yeah.
They're just interested in power. Usually totalitarians are more interested. They have a vision.
There's a vision with totalitarian regimes.
Authoritarians,
right.
They don't have vision because the only thing they care about is
power. Yes. The totalitarian person wants to restructure society and have it just one under him. And the authoritarian, they don't have a vision. They often are just kleptocrats. They just want to steal from the resources and so forth and stay in power as long as they can indefinitely. There was an interesting thing that I saw with Singapore, which is authoritarian. And you're reminded of this when you kind of hear these kind of stories. And people kind of go about their day and they're probably not that affected by the fact that it's authoritarian on a day-to-day basis. But apparently someone did a poll whether or not people from Singapore were happy. And the poll was not very good. The results were that they were not that happy. And then the next day the government came out with a new poll to contrast with the other poll. And it turned out that Singapore people are really, really happy. And then they published it, and they wanted to make sure that everybody knew that. And it's that kind of thing that's a reminder of, you guys, we have a deal going on here. You guys got to pretend to be happy and pretend that we're not authoritarian. Yeah.
Maybe people are not exactly very happy, as the government says, but they're not completely unhappy either,
right?
Because then they would mobilize. So the government is doing something in that regard to keep
them. They're not unhappy enough that they're going to mobilize. Although the government makes you get a permit if you want to meet with more than five people. So there's rules, right? It's hard. Chris, and then Kim.
Yeah, but I'm really surprised when they're calling Singapore, because, well, obviously there are some unhappy people. You could say that for immigrants, because there's about 30% people who aren't probably Singaporean who are there, but that's because of the lack of liberties that they have, but they're usually prepared for that when they go there. And then there's the people who are local, they're usually used to the way Singapore works, so I'm
surprised. Yeah, I was surprised that they were unhappy, but polling techniques...
The standard of living itself is just...
Polling techniques, they can find ways to find these kind of answers, but the funny part is that the government is like, huh? Let's review this because they don't want people to be publicizing that kind of thing. Yeah, Guillermo?
Yeah, I think Singapore leads the way for happiness through economic freedom,
And I think that's the biggest beauty of Singapore.
That, go on, keep explaining.
Yeah, the economic freedom that Singapore has, the lack of taxes, the...
Oh, the taxation is pretty high.
They have taxes, it's an environment that's viewed favorably by business community to invest.
Exactly.
So they rank very highly on those kind of indicators.
That's why the government leaves the freeway for happiness.
Right, so people are well. There are people that are wealthy there.
Happy.
You can make money there, right? Okay. All right, so Lipset says that, and so this is what kind of gets into the Singapore case. He said that authoritarian regimes are not likely to be well-educated, and the population's not likely to be well-educated, or urbanized, or industrialized, or wealthy, or modernized. So Singapore is like the counter to this. Because he's saying, well, there's a correlation. He didn't say it was causation. He says there's a correlation between all the rich countries that are really well-educated or all democratic, and all the poor countries that are not that well-educated or industrialized or urbanized are more likely to be authoritarian. And it still holds. I mean, there's a correlation. It's not causation, right? Because you have India that is still a lot of poverty and it's democratic, more or less. And then you have Singapore, it's the opposite. You have China that's growing. But the cases that prove his theory to be correct are countries like Taiwan. They had economic growth, and then you started to see a push for, you know, democracy, and the same with South Korea. Shaworsky, so he said, he's up there, that economic development explains the durability of dictatorship, which I mentioned. Michael Ross says resources explain dictatorship. Or not, that countries that have a lot of resources makes it easier for them to sustain their dictatorships because they can use those resources, revenues, to repress, and because they can use the resource revenues to buy off support. Moore talks about the lack of a bourgeoisie. That's Barrington Moore, it's like, I think, 1966, social origins of dictatorships and so forth. He talks about the lack of a bourgeoisie, that countries that have a bourgeoisie are going to be more likely to be democratic. But then another book by Rushmeyer, Stevens, and Stevens, RSS, is that as they're known, Rushmeyer, Stevens, and Stevens, they said, well, actually, bourgeoisies in Latin America, they were totally fine with dictatorship because they were maybe benefiting from the situation. They weren't pressuring for the demise of dictatorships at all. What you actually need is a combination of a bourgeoisie and organized labor to help pressure for it. Ethnic diversity, what do you think about ethnic diversity? Do you think it is good for democracy or not? Do you think that it helps, Chris?
Depends on the relations between the ethnic groups.
Yes, good.
And their willingness to cooperate.
Yes.
And, yeah, that's
so, it, they, yes, there are a lot of scholars who say there's a depend factor. Yeah.
If there are strong institutions, I think it would be a country, the country would be one of the best democracies if they have good institutions.
Yeah.
Operation of powers, yeah.
If they have strong institutions to work and manage these groups, it doesn't always have to be a bad thing. Inga and then Maluka? No.
Yes.
Okay. Inga, Bolivia,
then again, we have places like Bolivia, which has the most indigenous people in the world, and at least 20 different languages, and it's just been like historically incredibly racist. Like, all the white people have all the power, and the rest of you could just stay up in the mountains or something. So.
Yeah. So, but it's not been that. It hasn't really had a history of democracy. It hasn't managed things very well, and a lot of this they've had trouble. A lot of countries in Latin America have had trouble with their indigenous people in that they have not tried to include them. They've tried to just dislocate them from the process. So in this case, you see it's not been very good for democracy. Raluca, and then Tommy.
I think it depends on the percentage of the population as well. Because the bigger the groups are, and if they don't get along, then the higher the tensions will be in the country. So institutions might not work just because of the tensions, not because they're not well established.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they find that definitely to be the case when you have two or three big groups. The identity is very strong on an ethnic level, and they cannot keep passing. When it's a lot of ethnic diversity, it's not that big of a problem. Dominic?
Yeah, so I was just going to give the example of a country with strong institutions, but big ethnic tensions, that is Belgium.
Yes,
the main
yes.
one at the moment, which has the record, world record for not having a government.
Right.
Like 420 days or something.
Right.
I think at one point the wives of the
politicians copied, I can't remember which African country,
Kenya.
And said they would withhold sex unless they managed to actually sign up. So
I think that worked.
The only institution they had to really get talking together, I think, was actually the royal family. The royal family were president. I'm not sure one of the two.
I don't know about the Belgian. I knew that they didn't have a government
because of this tension. Yeah,
right?
But apparently the only way it kind of got resolved in the end, I think it's the monarchy that kind of stepped in.
Okay. But yeah. There's that example in Canada, I mean, but Belgium isn't going to fall apart. It probably
no,
isn't
it's
fall
not.
Apart.
Well, there was kind of talking about something.
Right, but it's still a good example because it's probably going to hang together, in spite of not having much in common with the other supposedly. And the Canadian case too, because I think there was a point where the Quebec wanted to go on its own. This is no longer the case.
There's talk of that in the Flemish section. There's a lot
right.
of talk about it.
But
it's
it'll be.
Advanced.
I think it'll be talk, but it won't come to fruition. I mean, you could disagree.
Well, you could say the same with Scotland and Wales. And
right, but they're still here, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Enough.
Yeah,
well.
What
does
that
mean,
diversity in Belgium,
Yes. So you have French speaking, and then you have Flemish speaking. And there's also a small German-speaking population.
It's tiny, it's like 5%.
Right, but it's mainly the French and the Flemish.
It's about 60% Flemish, and the Flemish section is the kind of better off.
Right, than the French
more
section.
More industrialized, more money.
Right, and so because when you have ethnic lines that are also divided on economic lines, that becomes a problem. Like if they were both equal economically, it would probably be not as important. It's the same as the French in Canada have the same kind of feelings of not feeling that they are benefiting as much. Okay, so is it an impediment? I mean, it depends. We talked about this. So we'll talk now about the types of dictatorships, which I've already talked to you about before. But we'll go over each one briefly, and then you can think about what the implications are. So we have Videla from Argentina during the military dictatorship from 1976 till I think he was ousted in like 82, somewhere around there. Military rules to military junta. I think I have another one coming up here. Okay, that's the old leader of China, Hu Jintao. Says a single party is in power, and they're making decisions. So what that would mean with the military juntas in power, a couple things. First of all, you've got a small group leading. That's never good, but it could be worse. You've got people from the military leading. Again, nothing against the military, but that's never good because they're not trained in how to run a country. And they have very high levels of confidence in their ability to do so. Single party have a lot more people that are running things. So we can make a big contrast between Mao, China, and China after he died. He was running the country, running the economy into the ground. Millions of people died under his policies. Terrible policies. And then he died, and the party became more inclusive, and there were more checks and balances, and they even institutionalized secession. So it's every 10 years. It's very predictable. And you could make a prediction that China is not going to really change that much, no matter who's in power. I mean, they've got a new leader, great. It's about the party, really, at the end of the day, and it's going to be very steady, because there's just so many people involved. Personalists, like Idi Amin, one person holds all the power, or like Lukashenko in Belarus, like we mentioned before, or Ferdinand Marcos of the Philippines. One person has it all. I mean, there isn't anything else. He really destroyed everything. So military is weak, ineffective, legislature no longer exists, bureaucracy doesn't exist, and also no political parties that are functioning. Hybrid are a combination of the two, like Castro, where you have a party and a leader that might be really powerful, or like Egypt, military and Mubarak were quite powerful. So that's a really interesting thing about a hybrid. So if you have a dictatorship, we have a really powerful military and a very powerful leader. So they ousted Mubarak, but the military is still there. And it kind of left, but then it came back. And it's probably going to be very powerful behind the scenes for decades to come. It will probably leave, there will be elections, and there will be not a whole lot of freedom for whoever is in charge until, you know, some more time, until you have some more time for some democratic culture to take hold. monarchies function quite a bit like single parties because you have a monarch, and then he's checked by all these family members, and decisions are made a little bit more slowly. There's exceptions, though, because there's some monarchs that have power only in their own hands, and they operate very similarly to like a personalist leader, like Iran under the Shah, like... Well, there's actually more checks and balances on the leadership, but that's a good one to contrast. Like the in Iraq, monarchy after Faisal died, it was falling apart and the leadership was very poor and personalistic. Libya, before Gaddafi took over, and then another personalist dictatorship took over, and so forth. And so there we have Mubarak, who's a hybrid, and I think I have a monarchy next with Abdullah of Saudi Arabia. Okay. Always smiling. It's like, I have a lot of oil. Always smiling. Okay, so with the military, where do they emerge? They mainly emerge in Latin America. There's Pinochet and his henchmen behind him. And you see the military dictatorships in Argentina and in Chile and Brazil, Bolivia, Paraguay with Stroessner, Peru, not so much Colombia or Venezuela, but also Salvador, Guatemala, briefly Panama. I mean, they just have long years of military rule that you could accumulate, and you could look at the region's percentage of military rule versus others, and it's much higher. They emerge for a couple of reasons. One, the U.S. gave Latin America tons of military aid, like millions and millions, I mean, really, tremendous amount. Two, the U.S. also funded these schools for the military. And during these schools, they were told that the military is suited to rule, like that they should be involved in governance and so forth. Three, gaps between rich and poor in Latin America are really high, the highest in the world. Because of that, that means there's going to be a lot of unrest on the left or right spectrum. Peasants who are dislocated and left out of things and so forth. And then that there's a theory by Jose Noon where you have big gaps between rich and poor, then that's going to see the high likelihood of the military stepping in to take over power to suppress any potential communist or leftist revolutions. And four, the U.S. just continually supported these military dictatorships during the Cold War, did not care about human rights abuses at the time, and then eventually they finally said they cared. So there we see why military dictatorships emerged and why this was the case, mainly in Latin America. All right, any questions about this? Okay, we'll turn to the East Asian parties. A lot of them were communists, a lot of them were in Eastern Europe as well. So a lot of it had to do with where communism emerged. But there are also single parties in Botswana. It's not a dictatorship, but it's had a party in power for a long time. And you see that Japan also has had a single party in power. It's not a dictatorship, but a lot of the funding was just economic, not military. So you wouldn't see that military institution grow so much. And there was just more checks and balances on the leaders due to the fact that pre-existing institutions weren't destroyed by colonial powers. And more infrastructure, there was just a lot of emphasis on economic growth, which necessitated strong parties, and the parties weren't being dismantled constantly, or they were being supported by foreign powers. And we turn to Africa, there's Mobutu. Africa has had more personalist leadership because when they emerged after colonization, there were very little institutions that the leaders had to work with because whatever institutions they had were destroyed by colonial powers. So as they're starting from scratch, then the only thing that would emerge would be one leader who's very powerful. Yes?
And also because of Cold War.
Exactly, the Cold War as well, right? Because the money was being funneled directly to leaders, not necessarily to military. Sometimes it's just being sold, like small arms were being sold and so forth. But a lot of it was just money directly going to leaders themselves. Another reason is resources. Why would resources lend itself to personalist leadership more? Kai?
Is it because dictators can basically live off resources and not by the taxes of the people?
Right. So
they don't have to foster the development of the country.
they don't have to foster any kind of institutional development at all because they can live off resources. Luisa, do you want to add?
I was just trying to say that they don't collect taxes or anything from the public, so I don't feel they have to answer to them because they're basically self-funded.
Right, right. They can just kind of survive based on this. They don't even bother to collect taxes. It's just not even necessary. Well,
Sometimes to protect the resources from outside influences, so private companies that could come in and take the resources of the country.
So how does that connect with personalist rule? What do you mean by that? What were you saying? Go ahead and tell me what you were saying.
So basically, you know, they would take the resources other than the, for own advantage, like for the collective of the country as a whole, because, you know, you get, like the banana companies that
right?
went into...
Latin America?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, explain the way you're talking about. You're not saying anything
so
wrong.
Basically,
I'm just
they nationalize the resources. They keep it for themselves. They don't
it.
Give it to the public.
Yes, yes, exactly.
Them.
Okay, good.
There's the other case as well that when corporations try to exploit their resources, it's much easier to have one leader to which
yes.
pay to, so that
just they just deal with one person who they give a big kickback to. Exactly, Raluca and then Kai, and then Kara.
In the case of a more paranoid leader, you wouldn't like the outside interference at all. The private companies from the outside might stage a coup or something on you.
They don't like anybody, not just outside people. They don't like inner people either.
So
people inside
exploit it themselves
mm-hmm.
and deal with it in house.
Yes. See. Okay. So you are leading a country that has tons of diamonds or gold or copper or whatever. And you know you can pocket most of the money for it. I mean, you're going to be very paranoid, right? Because you have landed on this large present that you don't want to ever have to leave. And so it leads to all kinds of tactics to just cling on to power as long as possible and to deinstitutionalize any potential challengers, both external and internal. Someone's hands up. Kai and then Kara.
I'm right to say that Asian countries, like single party system, worked well because there was no resources there. So
yeah, there could be a connection because they had to have more technocrats involved. They had to recruit more people involved and try to create better policy.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, the decisions are being made by one person, and these decisions are often very bad because they don't surround themselves by experts, people with knowledge. On
leaders have to invest in Asia to the people in general to actually get them.
They right. They
like
can't survive if they
taxes.
Don't produce something. Kara.
It's kind of like what everyone said already.
It's
just
okay.
Like using it as bribes to people.
Yeah. Yeah. The resources they can use as bribes more easily to kind of prop themselves up. Okay. Excellent. Monarchies emerged in the Middle East, and it was really an implementation by the West, not necessarily completely indigenous. There were some elements, traditional elements, that they tapped into, royal families that they sort of used that they thought were going to help create stability in these regions. They thought that monarchy would be the most stable region. And when a monarchy really functions like a ruling family, like a dynastic monarchy, and not like one person making decisions, they have been really stable. I mean, they have really weathered the Arab Spring, even though there was uprisings going on in Bahrain, they just stuck it out. And a lot of it is because decisions are not made that erratically, actually. Though you may not agree with what the monarchies are doing, they don't zigzag all over the place in terms of their policy. And that then will lead to stability. So they emerged mainly in the Middle East, probably because of foreign involvement, foreign implementation of these types of regimes. There's some non-oil monarchies as well, Morocco and Jordan, but it was a foreign thing. It was not like an indigenous type of thing. Outside of the Middle East, you had Nepal was a monarchy no longer, and Swaziland.